So Andrew is talking about mixing metals and snakes. I'm just going to hand it over to him and see how it goes.
Morning, everybody. Okay, so maybe before I begin, I'll tell you where I come from. This is much more of an application talk compared with most of the other talks at the conference. So I'm not going to teach you much about Python. You could probably teach me a lot about Python. I'm a metallurgical engineer, so I run my own consulting business, and I do a bit of research at the University of Pretoria. So my focus is more on the technical content inside this, but you'll see how we use the software platforms to actually get these things accessible to people who actually need them. Okay, so mixing metals with snakes, the title is just, okay, Python in the metallurgical industry, the mining and metals industry. And we're trying to move the industry forward, trying to make a contribution, and I think you'll see why. So the purpose of this presentation is to demonstrate to you how we use Python as part of the software that we develop to improve our understanding of complex high temperature processes. And we're also using it to develop new process technologies. And also, I think on the software side, I don't claim to be a software expert on any part of the stack, especially on the UI side. So any feedback or ideas are very welcome. So I'm going to just briefly talk about the South African economy, how the mining and metals industry fits into that, the company that I work for, and then thermochemistry. I'll give you a long lecture about thermochemistry with lots of mathematics, and so you'll definitely learn there. And then modeling and simulation software that we use to get insight into these things, because they can be quite complex, and then I'll close. Okay, so the South African economy, I don't think anybody will disagree with me if I say we need development and growth. We need better education, better healthcare, infrastructure, all of these things. There's a lot of poor people that we need to help out in some way, or help them to help themselves out. And somebody needs to pay the bill. So who's going to pay the bill? Which part of this economy has the capacity to carry the country and get us off our knees and onto our feet? Now, I believe the one part of this country that can do this is the mining and metals industry. It has the capacity to do this. We have a wealth of minerals, various minerals. Some of them we've got more than anybody else in the world, platinum, manganese, chrome, etc. And in terms of value, Citibank did a study in 2010. In terms of the mineral wealth that we've got in the ground, we've got more than anybody. Okay, so still, even after decades of mining and producing stuff, we still have the most. Okay, so but we do have several challenges in our industry. Rising electricity costs are significant, especially for high temperature processing, where you have to heat up and melt stuff to about 1700 degrees Celsius. That sucks quite a bit of electrical energy out of the network. Labor unrest is not friendly to us. Increasing cost, the ores that we have to mine are becoming more and more difficult. The guys early on cherry picked the nice stuff, and now it's becoming more difficult to mine and process the rest. We also have lost many, many good people out of this country. In the chrome industry specifically, we're finding it difficult to compete just because of the way that the composition of our ores is different from the ones in Kazakhstan, for example. They can make high-value products really easily, directly. We cannot. So we have to come up with new ideas to be able to compete. Now, the current status of this industry is many smelters have shut down. Eskom has even paid people to not switch on their furnaces so that they can have extra capacity on the network. So you're actually paying people not to work. And we're doing less and less value add. and we're increasing our ore exports. So we dig it out of the ground, put it on a train, and it's out of the country. And we haven't added much value to that. So we're getting less and less for the minerals that we have in the ground. Other guys are getting more, China, Japan, Europe, etc. So yeah, that's the picture. Lots and lots of ore running on rails to the harbors and out of the country, and we're getting a pittance for it. Okay, so my company, what does it mean, Exmente? It's Latin. I kind of like Latin names for things. It means from the mind. It's because we try to think about things, we like thinking about understanding things. One of my Australian friends says it doesn't mean from the mind, it means we are out of our minds, but yeah, that's his opinion. So we are a bunch of metallurgical and chemical engineers, and one or two software engineers as well. Very small company, we do consulting work, modeling and simulation work, process control, information systems for these metallurgical plants. And we really like understanding stuff well. We like deep insight and solving difficult problems, and we like hard stuff in terms of temperature. So how do we do it? We build relationships with our clients. My relationship with the University of Pretoria also helps me get into contact with really smart young people. We do research and development work, both software development, but also development of new chemical processes and things. And then we develop software, because software is a vehicle through which we can deliver to our clients the things that we figured out and make it accessible to them. Okay, so I said we like hot stuff. This is a picture of a furnace, a three-phase AC furnace. So we chuck a whole bunch of stuff in there, switch on the electricity, and there's a big arc welder. So whatever's in there melts. When it's done, you tap it out. That's the one thing about pyrometallurgy, it's really easy to get good pictures. Okay, sometimes we have to granulate it, break it up into small little particles, or you cast it into molds. Those molds can be handled and they can either be used in the next process or it can be sold overseas for further processing. Okay, now thermochemistry. Here comes the math. It's also called chemical thermodynamics. Now the good of that is it's incredibly powerful for high temperature processes, because things happen very, very quickly at 1700 degrees Celsius. And the one thing that normally keeps you away from equilibrium is kinetics. But because we are using high temperature processes, whatever thermodynamics tells us gets us to a really good estimate of what will actually happen in that process. So if we can understand this well, we can think and analyze and work with these processes really well. The not so good is, it is quite an abstract field. I think most students at university are just, when they come into contact with it, is they're just scared enough of it that they never want to return. So many people find it difficult to work with it or to really understand it, and it's often misunderstood and poorly used. That's the reality of it. We try to teach the kids at university this, but I'm afraid we're not too successful. Now, in terms of demonstrating the difficulty of this, now Josiah Willard Gibbs, he is seen as the father of thermochemistry. He did incredible work. I mean, people talk a lot about Einstein. This guy, he's up there with him. And someone said, I don't know if it was actually said, but it illustrates. Only one man left who could understand Gibbs's papers. That was Maxwell, and now he's dead. So if you directly read Gibbs's papers, they are quite nasty, but fortunately we do have textbooks and things to help us. So how do we get the benefits of thermochemistry to the industry if most of our engineers don't, they're really not able to use it, they don't understand the theory well enough, etc. So one of the things that we do is we do sell specialist thermochemistry software. I'm an agent for guys in America and Germany, but we've got limited success with that. So we can also, in our company, do everything for them. We can do the modeling, the simulation, the investigations and everything, but then we're the bottleneck. And I mean, we want the country as a whole to progress and go forward. So the next idea is to put thermochemistry into these guys' hands in industry in a way that they can use it. So that's what we're trying at the moment. We started with this the software that you'll see at the end in May this year, so it's still fairly new. So modeling and simulation, where did we come from? It's been a long journey. In between 93 and 98, I built my own thermochemistry software in C++. It was good fun, but I'm glad it's over. We built a flow chart in a software package called Jensen G2. It's a hugely expensive real-time expert system. Really good software, but $500,000 for a single license. Yeah. From 1999 to 2004, we bought thermochemistry software, an API, which we could programmatically work with. And we integrated this into Excel and VBA and VB, and we built a little toolkit we called ThermoLab at that stage to represent flow sheets and depict how the processes work so that we can have a picture of it. And we made great strides. It was at that time that I did my PhD at the University of Pretoria, and I was able to use that fairly primitive software to get some sensible insights. Up to 2012, we integrated ChemApp into .NET, so we were Microsoft partners and all those nice things. And we built UIs with WPF, and from at that point we started calling it MSIM, which is Xmete Modeling and Simulation Software. And since 2013, we've made a big move to open source. We've integrated ChemApp, and I'll talk about ChemApp a little bit later. It's the API. Into Python, so now I can do all of what I could previously do in Python, which is really nice. You don't have to compile anything anymore. And the UI is now web-based, and we're hosting these things on cloud servers. I will show you that at the end. But before we get to that, when I was doing a course in modeling at the University of Pretoria, I had this idea that in the first two-day block, I would ask the guys who attended to write their own little modeling framework. I've been doing it for years, so it kind of made sense to me. After the first day, I knew this is not going to happen. So I literally went overnight and started writing the framework. And that piece of software is now an open source project that you can see on GitHub and read the docs and all of those places. Now the motivation for this is, okay, it's again a Latin name, so it comes from auxilia or auxilium. And the idea is that the guys in the industry need some help. So let's try to help them out and do a lot of the math and the theory for them and just give the software away. So the University of Pretoria, in the second year, the engineering students do Python, so which is great. So it made sense for us to build this thing in Python so that when they graduate, once they go into industry, they have no excuse. They have tools, and if they have to do mass and energy balances, they can do this quite quickly. And we wanted to put these tools into their hands and make them more productive and more able to solve problems. So what can it do? There's some tools for chemistry and material physical properties, like what is the heat capacity of water or the thermal conductivity of air, etc., that we use to solve heat transfer problems and things. And then all different kinds of models that you find in a textbook to calculate heat transfer. It's readily available in there so that you don't have to study the textbook 3 weeks later, have maybe something working in Excel. It's there, you can simply use it. So there's also modeling, a simple modeling framework in there, so we can model metallurgical processes. There's also a full double entry system for finance in there, and a business modeling framework, because we're not just pure scientists, we're engineers, so we have to always interpret what we do within the financial world as well. So I'll quickly show you just a little bit of code. It's really very simple. So it's a Python package that you simply, you import a few of these calls to calculate molar masses and do conversions. Now, if you're in Excel, these guys are addicted to Excel. Metallurgical and chemical engineers, they are Excel people. So when you open Excel, of course, Excel knows nothing about chemistry. And you have to Google or find molar masses somewhere. That's usually what you need to do. So in Python, if you do this, and if we have these things loaded, you can simply do a few function calls and you've got the molar masses sorted out. It has a parser. I think it's called Parsimonious, the toolkit in Python. And then we can also convert compounds and answer questions like, if you have 1 ton of iron ore, which is Fe2O3, how much iron can I get out of that? Now, usually you have to divide by the molar mass of this and multiply by the molar, all of those things, all the gymnastics is done in the background. So it can also do a little bit of thermochemistry. It's got a small database of compounds that it knows the heat capacity and entropy and all of those things for. So the score that I just did, list compounds, shows you the database that's in there. You can modify it, add your own stuff as well. And then you can do simple calculations, which would usually take junior metallurgical engineers or process engineers quite a bit of time to structure all of that in Excel. Okay, really simple stuff. So if anybody likes chemistry a bit, you're more than welcome to come up with suggestions and we'll contribute to the code, send us pull requests, etc. Any help would be very welcome. Okay, so the next step is I'm going to talk about ChemAppPy. Now, Auxi can do quite a bit, and it's really quite useful already. But it can't do detailed thermochemistry. It can't answer the real questions that we have for high temperature processes, for example. And we need quite a bit more to study complex multi-phase equilibria, because if you take iron ore and coal and you heat it up to 1700 degrees, what will happen? Stuff will melt, but it will also react. If we have all of these components that you can do the chemical calculations with, it'll tell you pretty much exactly what's going to happen. Okay, so FactSage is an interactive UI tool. It's a commercial tool, also quite expensive. It's really got very powerful capabilities in terms of thermochemistry, but it's interactive, so it's difficult for high workloads. If you want to do thousands of calculations, it's terrible. It's got its own proprietary macro language, which I would not recommend to anybody. ChemApp is the engine behind FactSage that does the actual calculations, and it's an API, and you can access it via C or Fortran. Now, my friends in the metallurgical industry, I don't know virtually any of them who know C or Fortran. So it's very flexible and powerful, extremely, but it's difficult to master and use. It's got this very cryptic API. TQINI must mean something to you. TQCE. So it's 4-letter or 5-letter function calls that you have to memorize, and it's really difficult. So what we did is we just wrapped this API into Python so that it basically exactly the same as it is in the documentation, you can use it. So we didn't make any changes. So we pulled that came up by raw, because it's still very raw, very cryptic. But at least it's now available in Python. And then we made came up by friendly, and we gave it more readable API calls, so that once you know a bit about the acronyms that we use, you'll be able to figure out the function calls for yourself. So it's kind of self-documenting. So now you've got complete flexibility, rapid development, it's a rich and productive environment, and it's relatively quick to master. So the core concepts behind this friendly interface is the calculations. You do these high-level commands, where in the normal KMAP interface you will use five calls just to load a file. In the friendly interface you have one line to load a file. And you can also do parallel execution with it. The storage of all the data, we pack it all into JSON, and then we store it in MongoDB, because it's these hierarchical documents. And one of these calculations can be up to half a meg in size. And then we visualize the results, also again by using high-level commands, and the tool in the background is matplotlib that we use. Now I'll just show you some results, just the format of the graphs and things, one example. What we're doing here is we're taking chrome ore. In the bushveld, there's lots of chromites, that's where the platinum comes from as well. And we take coal, and you put these things together, and you take it to a specific temperature. And we will increase the temperature on each of these graphs. So this is a one example. So on the x-axis, you add more and more coal. Coal is your reductant. This is at 800 degrees Celsius. And what we see here is we make a little bit of metal. This is probably mostly iron. And then the rest is, it's still pretty much rock. So not too much is happening there. Then we heat it up to 900. There is a little bit of a change, but it's not really very exciting. And in that way, you can increase the temperature, and you see that there's more metal that's forming. That's what we want. We want to make ferrochrome, because ferrochrome we can use to make stainless steel. There's a bit of calculation problems there were in that case. And up to the end, 1700 degrees, the end result is that blue at the bottom is your ferrochrome, a liquid ferrochrome alloy that you can tap out of the furnace. At the top, you've got liquid slag that you can also tap. Slag is a molten oxide mixture. So it's a silicon dioxide, aluminium oxide, those types of things that are now molten. Okay. So for this study that I did for one of our customers, we did more than 60,000 calculations. We stored all of that in Mongo, and we were able to use Python to manipulate this data remotely. It is extremely powerful. And we were able to give the client a lot more insight into how the processes work and what they could do to improve them. So in summary, I did more than 60,000 calculations, and the next week the guy can tell me, but okay, I've got three more ore compositions for you, can you do it again? Before KenMapPy, I would just die. But now you've got the scripts. You put the data in there, you rerun the scripts, and you basically spend time interpreting the results, which is what an engineer should do. All this gymnastics with generating results and putting it into a database, that should be automated as far as possible. Okay. So visualization with matplotlib, I think we can go way beyond what we're currently doing, but it's already very powerful, and the insights that us and the clients get from this is phenomenal. And we can also now start thinking about optimization. So we can wrap these calculations into optimizers, SciFi has some optimization routines, and that's in the future what we can also do. Okay. So this was still, Auxi is programmatic, but it's fairly simple and not so powerful. ChemAppPy, much more powerful, but it's still programmatic, and my clients will not program in Python. It's just no way. Okay, so now the next step is, how do I get these things into their hands? Because I can't run all the simulations for them. I just don't have the time. So we want to model processes quickly and easily, so that we don't spend a lot of time on it, but we want to limit the amount of programming that we do. I think you always have to do a bit of programming. And we also want to minimize the IT impact in terms of, okay, I've shipped off a version and there's something wrong and I have to reship it and they have to download and uninstall and reinstall and the libraries are not on that PC, all those nice things. We don't want that. And the models must be easy to understand, well documented, easily accessible to our co-workers and our customers, and they must be reusable as far as possible. And it must also be easy to run large numbers of scenarios. That one we haven't sorted out yet. Okay, so the core concepts, the calculations that we do, that I'm going to show you now, it's steady state mass and energy balances. So it's fairly simple calculations, but there's a lot of sophistication now running in the background. It's based on all of this thermochemical calculations, and the guy running the model doesn't even know that it's there. He doesn't have to know that it's there. So we do detailed thermochemistry with ChemApp. The Python, we develop modeling frameworks in Python and material frameworks, so it's easy to work with materials and to build models. We store all of these things again in JSON. In this case, we don't use Mongo, we use Postgres. And then the front end we build with Django. I heard somebody saying earlier that in the mining industry, don't know if it's a good idea to use Django. It's working for now, but it's very small applications. We use Celery for background work because these calculations can take quite a lot of time and you don't want to hang up your front end. And then the normal HTML and JavaScript and CSS. Okay. So what it looks like, this is roughly what it looks like. Now the layout that we're trying to go for is we want to make it look like a Windows application as far as we possibly can, because all the guys that we work with live in Windows. So if there's file open, they'll probably be able to figure out what that does without me telling them. We've got a lot of work still on the user interface. But I've opened the model here. I'm running it off my cell phone, so it might be a little bit sluggish. But you give the model a name, you give it a code name. All the code names in the model we use inside Python. So if I refer to this object in Python, then it's mod underscore chr, so there's no spaces and those types of things. It can be a batch model or a continuous model. If you've just created it, the status will be unknown. You can add some descriptions to it. It's one of these lightweight markup languages that we use, so you can put bullets and all kinds of things in there. And the file that I've uploaded here, that contains all the thermochemical information. The details of the thermochemistry, if you click on the thermochemical system, then it should load that. These are all the elements in the system, all the pure phases, solutions, all the detail that we actually find in the processes. When we melt all the oxide, we've got this slag phase, which contains a mixture of all of those things. So it's huge in terms of the effort that's gone into that to create that. And you get a fairly good description of what the process actually does. The next step is, once you've got your thermochemical system loaded into it, then you can define materials. So we've got fluxes and ores and reductants, and we input the chemical assays in here, it's really easy to copy and paste this from Excel, because Excel is important. And then the next step is, once we've got materials, we define a whole host of model parameters, like the ambient temperature and pressure. If you're in the bushveld, you're not at one atmosphere like at the coast, and it might have an impact on the process. And we define smelting condition parameters. At what temperature are we going to operate this furnace? And various other parameters that we use to control it. So the clients basically interact with these parameters. The clients can't build these models. We build them, and then we give it to them, and they can play around with it to do whatever investigations they want. The nice thing is, we can now create a flow sheet to describe how the process works. Now, to quickly explain this to you, all the red things are related to energy, all the blue things are related to material. So we feed ore, flux, and reductant into the process. We add them all together with this combiner node. Then we strip some of the things out. We've got dust losses from the furnace, so we can strip off some dust. And some of the carbon that we put in the furnace are actually burnt off, so we remove that as well. We set the temperature of those waste streams as they go up. They come in at 25 degrees Celsius, but they don't go out to 25 degrees Celsius, so that costs energy. And once they heat it up, they leave the process. The rest of the feed that we actually are able to use, we use this isothermal equilibrium node. Now, that's actually all the chemical reactions that happen in the process. You tell it, go to 1700 degrees, and poof, it sucks a whole bunch of energy, takes it up in temperature, and all the reactions take place. The products of this, we take to a phase splitter, and we remove the gas, because the gas goes out of an off-gas duct. We remove the alloy is tapped, and we separate the slag from that, and that is also that. Okay. And once the model has run, we've got a series of calculations that you can do. Well, basically any calculation, because it's Python. You can define your calculations in Python, but there's also a standard set of reports that you can visualize all your input data, all the results. A very important view on a process is its mass and energy balance. Whatever comes in must go out, otherwise we're using a nuclear reactor of some sorts. And the same with the energy, whatever energy comes in must go out as well. Then we are not violating the laws of thermodynamics. And these types of things are what gives the customers insight into how much carbon will they consume to make this product, for example. How much energy will they consume to make this product? These reports are available on a web page like this, but you can also extract a TeX file, LaTeX file. So you can, if you're a LaTeX person, then you can quickly edit the report and produce a custom view on it. But it's also available in PDF, and some of the reports, just to make the customers happy, of course, you can export them to CSV and click on them, and you're in your nice little Excel world again. Okay, so that's MSIM. Okay, to conclude, in my world, Python is a really important enabling technology. It's easy to learn. It's something that you can expect chemical and metallurgical engineers to learn. The guys that work with me, they can digest it. C++, C#, all of the other languages, I have really no hope. We are now able to do really large-scale thermochemical investigations to gain insights into these processes and to come up with new process technologies. all the projects that we're currently running in the company are new processes that either use no electricity or very little electricity. So that's what South Africans are good at. If there's a problem, we fix it. So I'm working with really smart guys in industry. They might not understand the chemistry, but they understand their part of the deal really well. So there's now many possible applications with it. So we do process development, and we can do optimization and many other things. And we can now, with these tools, we can get chemistry into the hands of more people so that it's not only us who can do that. Thanks a lot.
Cool.
Thank you very much. That's fascinating to me, actually, since I did mechanical engineering. And did a bit of Python after that. So yeah, I mean, that was like a bit of a nightmare to try and do in MATLAB and all that. So that's really, really cool work. I'm sure some of you guys have found that interesting. And I hope that some of you have questions. So I'll run to you with the mic if you have a question.
We do have two. I didn't really see, is the modeling in the modeling software over here all based on sort of like perfect world sort of conditions? How closely do you expect the models to kind of follow what happens in like kind of real life, like the kind of expected composition or like reasonable bounds in terms of like the precision of the equipment that's being used? Do you do any of that data, or is that purely the mining company goes, oh, we've got shoddy equipment, let's adjust it by this, by that, based on looking at their Excel spreadsheets?
What we do is we create a really solid theoretical base, but that's a theoretical base. So to get to a point where we've got a good, valid representation of the actual process, we use these model parameters. And we compare the model results with what the actual process does, and then we tune the parameters so that we have a better representation. You never get a perfect representation. In some cases, though, we are working on processes that don't exist yet. In that case, we solely reliant on the theory, and it gets us pretty close. So other types of modeling work like heat transfer, etc. You can use to calculate heat losses, etc. So, but we can get fairly good representations of what the process should be doing.
Great talk. So. I just wanted to point out how big is your team, and for the flow diagram, have you tried using BigPython for that?
Our team, we're 5 people. We're currently looking for 2 more people on the software side. And are we using VPython? I have never heard of VPython, so now we're not using that.
Excellent methodology.
Thanks for the great talk. I had a friend in university who did chemical engineering and, as you say, really struggled with his thermodynamics course. Have you thought about taking these tools back to university to make the visualization of the process easier for students and stuff to get a handle up front?
Yes. I have a group of research students at the university, and they have access to this. Undergrad teaching, not yet. And also, we're starting to collaborate with Stellenbosch University on this as well, to make that accessible to them so that students can start using it to analyze processes.
We're almost identical company, except in possibly consumer goods, milk and milk processing stuff. I'm very interested in what libraries that you use for the drag and drop process creation.
Okay. I can't remember right now, but we can talk about it afterwards.
Okay, anyone else with questions? Okay, I'll ask my question. In terms of building the UI, how do you make decisions on that? Is it kind of just whatever makes sense to you, or do you have someone who's good with UI who researches how to do this? Because like insights into having file drop down.
We don't have anybody with UI. it's based on our experience, the best that we can think of, we do, and this was done, the UI was done in 5 weeks. So we really had virtually no time to complete it. The idea that we do have is we want to make this into an IDE type of editor with multiple buttons. Which, because there's a lot of things to look at, there should be a logging window, etc. And there are JSON libraries, I think, that we can use for that. Golden Layout is one of them. So that's what we think we will be doing in the future. But we want to recruit somebody who is good in building UIs.
Well, I think just making it logical to the person is a good start.
Yeah.
Okay, no more, any more questions? Now's your chance to shine. Okay, thank you very much.